My story is going to take us back 34 years in one day. 34 years ago, I was a passenger in a car that had an accident. It was the most pure kind of accident. There was no malice or alcohol or drugs or fooling around. It was just a night, a back road in Vermont, and a car that couldn't make a corner. And the car left the corner and went airborne and met a big old ironwood tree. And I happened to be in the back seat and took the brunt of that impact on my spine and broke my back in four places, and that left me paralyzed from the waist down. It also did a number of other things. It broke four ribs, broke all the bones in my left shoulder, broke my femur, and I lost my ears, but thankfully they were able to stitch them back on. And I didn't know about any of this until about 4 or 5 days later when I woke up in the hospital, and that's really where my story begins. My story begins with that day, about 4 or 5 days after, and I woke up in the hospital and it was in a striker frame. And what a striker frame is well, it was kind of homemade at that point, 35 years ago. It was a frame that they kept me in, and they rotated me every 2 hours. I affectionately called it my barbecue pit. And they did this every 2 hours, and so I happened to wake up face down. And I was looking at the ugly linoleum floor that makes up hospitals, because I woke up, I suppose some sounds, some beeps started going off, and then I heard this clippity clop, clippity clop, clippity clop, and immediately in my field of vision, I saw two wooden clogs. And for those of you who remember the 70s and 80s, people wore wooden clogs, and the wooden clogs belonged to a doctor, and I knew him as Dr. Clog. I actually would never meet Dr. Clog apart from his shoes. And he asked me if I knew where I was. I had no idea. What year it was, I guessed that one correctly. And what had happened to me? And I said, no, I have no idea. And he said, you were in a car accident. You broke your back and you'll never walk again. And he turned around and he walked away. And that was the last time I saw Dr. Clog. And suddenly at 16, I was confronted with an obstacle that I had to overcome, that I had to learn to overcome. And as I was searching to try to find what I was going to do, how I was going to recover from that, I started to think about the lessons that I had got from sports, from being a varsity football player and a varsity hockey player. I was a three-letter varsity sport player in my high school. And it occurred to me that this was an obstacle, like anything. And so I thought about it, and I languished in the hospital. In the hospital I was at in rural Vermont, they didn't really know what to do with a 16-year-old spinal cord injured patient, so they put me in the cancer ward with all the terminal patients, which in and of itself sounds like a depressing place, but it's a remarkable place. You learn a lot from the people there. And I was building this reservoir of strength from these people, and eventually I would go out to Colorado where I would do rehabilitation at Craig Hospital, and I started to meet other people in wheelchairs and people who were athletes, and it occurred to me at that point that I could still do things. And when I got out of rehab and I came back and I started going back to high school and getting back into life, I decided to become an athlete. And at about a couple of months when I was back, I signed up for a 10K. And I had no idea how I was going to do it. I was using a wheelchair. It was a 75-pound Everson Jennings stainless steel wheelchair. And to give you an understanding of what that means, the wheelchair I'm in now weighs about 20 pounds, right? A sporting chair, a racing chair, can weigh about 5 or 8 pounds. And so lugging the 75-pound wheelchair up the hills of rural Vermont, I was a little depressed when the walkers passed me, but I made up some time going downhill, and enough time. Physics was going to work in my advantage, and I made up enough time to win the race, and that started a return back to athletics and the things that I really loved, and It became the goal to get involved and do the sports that I loved. And I started thinking deeply about that as I would graduate from high school and go to college, that the skills that allow you to succeed in life are the ones that we get really early on, and most of us get them unknowingly through sport, whether it's t-ball or peewee or hockey or anything. It's working together, it's disciplining yourself, it's focusing, it's learning to communicate, it's setting a goal, it's achieving that goal, it's dealing with failure, it's picking yourself back up, brushing yourself off, and going on. It's dealing with things at that level. And you don't know when you're getting those, right? But you're getting them. And as I was able to take those sorts of skills and apply them, I started to have some success athletically and academically. As you heard, I'm a professor now, and I would go on to study at some elite universities and learn a lot, but still the great passion was sport. And when I returned back to Vermont after graduate school, I looked around me and I saw that Vermont didn't have too many opportunities for persons with disabilities to pursue sports. And it occurred to me that as I looked around, that's why I didn't see a lot of persons with disabilities doing things, because they were excluded from sport. And not intentionally, and looking back at my own story, it was a struggle when I came back to the town where I went to school. The school was inaccessible and they wanted me to go to a different school, which seemed reasonable at the time, except they were my arch rival. And that couldn't happen. And so I struggled, got back into that school, was able to complete my education there. And when looking around at what makes success, it was those same sets of values that I had learned from sport. And I set about to change the lives of Vermonters with disabilities by starting an organization that would provide them the opportunity to engage in recreational and competitive sports. And I did that. And about 14 years ago, we were finally incorporated, and the Northeast Disabled Athletic Association, which I'm now the board president and founder of, started. We were incorporated, and we started a sled hockey team. We started our power soccer team, and we've hosted a number. We now serve about 400 to 500 disabled athletes a year. We've had some great success, and the success comes from getting people involved at that level of athleticism and letting them move the muscles that they can and getting them to allow themselves the opportunity to take a challenge and grow with it and go beyond it. And I look back those 34 years in a day, and it literally, my accident was yesterday, 34 years ago, and it's kind of macabre. A lot of people who have catastrophic injuries celebrate those. They have an anniversary. I get together some friends. We have some beers. We talk about it because it's an important milestone in our life, and it's those kinds of things that occur to us that allow us to gain strength from it by taking it as a challenge. And it's in those 34 years in a day, I keep wanting to say 35, right? I learned that the world is not going to be an easy place to deal with. Dealing with a disability every day, you're going to be confronting prejudice and bias, architectural barriers, attitudinal barriers. But those are going to bury you unless you see them as opportunities. And every time you have an opportunity, you can grow from it. You can accomplish things. You can change things. You can change yourself. And sharing my passion with sport, both competitively and as a coach and as a trainer, I've been able to provide people with disabilities the opportunity to pursue those very same things and meet with success. I'll share one story with you where there's a young man who started out 4 or 5 years old. He had a tumor on his spine that when they removed the tumor, they left him paralyzed. And because he was so young with his disability, he'd never known sport. And his mother came to us and said, "We'd really like him to be involved. Is there anything you can do?" We had a wheelchair basketball program. We got him involved in that. But he didn't know really what to do at the time. He'd spit at us. I mean, he was a really smart kid. He'd punch you, and it's not supposed to happen on the basketball court. But over time, he started to learn how to play basketball, learn how to be a teammate. And of course, he didn't know those because he was excluded from any kind of physical education or sport. And he would go through a number of our programs. He'd be a captain of one of our teams. He'd eventually go to college, and now he's employed as an athletic director at a college. Right. We've had a number of other successful stories where Local Vermont kids have gone on to the U.S. development team for the Paralympics. We've sponsored two Paralympians, Vermont's only Paralympians to date. Alicia Beresford Dana from Putney, who is now the world champion hand cyclist, and she won the Vermont City Marathon a couple of years ago, and she represented the United States in London in a number of years ago. And Stephen Lawler, the Burlington native and skier, who was in Sochi this past winter. And there are athletes. And so sport becomes this way of developing those sets of skills that allow you to succeed in life. And it's really something that is that I can attest to personally. And I like to share that. And through my organization, we are able to build the, and help the lives of persons with disabilities. So love to talk to you later on. And thank you for the opportunity.